Good morning, church. How are you doing today? It's good to see all of you. Glad to have each and every one here, whether regular or guests. We are also mindful and thankful to have our guests joining us online and some of our members joining us online as well. We're thankful to have this opportunity. As it were, we are smack dab in the middle of our series called Social Church, where we're talking about online issues. And so this morning, church, we have got some things to talk about. And I know it's never good news when you hear someone say, hey, honey, when you get home from work, we need to talk. I don't think today will be quite as somber as those sorts of conversations, but I do think that we're going to get into some very serious territory that needs to be covered. I don't think we spend enough time talking about these sorts of things. I have a question before we get into it, though. Just think about this with me. What do you think social media, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, all of those different venues and forms would look like if our favorite people, who we recognize from Scripture, had? What would happen if Peter had a Twitter? What are some of the things that they would say if they could put on social media the things that they saw and actually wrote down in many cases? What would some of those things come out looking like? Have you ever stopped to wonder? Do you think the New Testament church's social media back in 33 AD would look a lot like ours today? Would we find the Apostle Paul very concerned about the types of statues and flags flying in the Roman Empire? What would they look like back in Old Testament times? Those were some pretty crazy times. Well, I dug up some posts from the olden days, and I think we'll take a look at these. This is our friend Ehud, personal trainer, made a Facebook post saying that he was going to go help King Eglon cut the fat out of his diet. Sounds like something appropriate that he would write. Shadrach is with the boys about to attend a roast with King Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel is concerned. Nebuchadnezzar says it's lit. Everybody is having a lot of fun making fun of Noah, who's warning everyone that God is mad and water is going to fall from the sky. Tubal-Cain is especially amused and is cranking up his music, of which he is so fond, to drown out the noise of all the hammering. Peter stepped off the boat and John had to capture the moment. Imagine if the disciples had their phones out while they're watching Jesus work miracles to record all of those moments. Imagine if they could record that and put that on a Facebook Live or an Instagram story. Simon, called Peter, is obviously defending the fact that he is the only other person that has taken even another step on water out to Jesus, and in his opinion, it still counts. But what if there were posts from the Pharisee News Network? What if there was misinformation from the olden fake news media? Warrants issued for Jesus of Nazareth, the so-called Messiah. Key witness testimony before the Sanhedrin shows that he is an enemy of the state, an enemy of God, an enemy of the Roman Empire, declares that he will tear the temple down and raise it and build another with his own hands. Taken out of context, twisted, fires up the mob. What if social media looked like that back in those days? What would it look like today if this is how people carried themselves and behaved? What would the world look like? Seriously, it's kind of funny when you think about that. It's hilarious to look at what some of these folks may have shared out there. Peter probably would have had to go and delete a post. Solomon would be dropping daily wisdom proverbs, and David would probably have a new psalm music video every single week that came out. James and John would probably be calling for drone strikes, hashtag sons of thunder. I wonder if Absalom's political tirades against his father would be as ugly as our political tirades are today with the mudslinging. I wonder what it would be like if David was caught spending way too much time on Bathsheba's profile. I wonder if there'd be a group of conspiracy theorists posting all of their beliefs that the world was actually round. The possibilities are actually endless. This could be a lot of fun, but we have to focus for a few minutes today. We do have to talk very seriously about this, because I think it's clear from what we see and what we experience has got many of us feeling anxious and frustrated that we've greatly underestimated this thing, social media, that we all participate in. And because we've underestimated, it's led us to a dangerous place, a place where great potential exists, but because we haven't had enough conversations like this, much damage is being done, discord is being sowed, relationships are being wounded, churches are suffering unrest, being burned, and if you would believe it, congregations are actually breaking and splitting and dividing. The most serious of all of this is that the witness and testimony of the saints, the reputation of Christ and his church, the ecclesia called out, is being damaged and tarnished badly. You know, for a long while as a family, we've had this concern that is actually valid. It can be easy to be active in the local church. It can be easy to attend regularly, do the right things, say the right things, live a good life, so to speak. In the Sundays, live a life that is totally different from what we represent at a worship service. A life that, when others come in contact with it, unfortunately, they leave feeling like, if that's what Christianity is really about, that feels really hypocritical to me, and I don't need that in my life. Matter of fact, I don't want anything to do with it. I'll never set foot in a church building ever again. We have for a long time been aware and warned of this and strived against worshiping in one world and living in another. Rightfully so. But we seem to have missed this one. You see, there's an entirely new dimension of ourselves that has been created over the last 2 decades, the last 20 years or so, one that we manage with intense fervor. It's our digital self, our online avatars that we curate to our liking on multiple social media platforms, where we can, for the most part, be exactly what we want to be, say what we want to say, put on whatever filter or face, even if it's a puppy dog, that we feel like putting on that day. And we have freedom, in most instances, to let that be whatever we decide. It's a pretty new concept. It's a pretty new dimension of us. And it's made great changes in how we live, even in the last 10 years. And as much as we accept and recognize that this online presence is a big part of how we conduct our lives now, we've also failed to take seriously our responsibility to it and its power. People get really brave behind a keyboard. Have you noticed? Anonymity provokes all sorts of courage inside of people that they don't have otherwise. We'll say a lot of things behind a keyboard or behind a phone screen that we would never say in person. We'll laugh at things that we would never even hear uttered in person. We'll look at things that we would never want anyone to know that we looked at. We'll talk to people in ways that we would never speak to them face to face. The screens have created another part of us to put on display. I'm afraid it's the same problem online that we have through the week in some cases. That is, when we look at the things we post, we look at the things we share, we look at the things we say to one another, whereas we struggle with worshiping in one world and living in another throughout the week, I think we struggle with worshiping in one world and posting in another. This recent time of unstress, this unrest, this distress, whether it's COVID-19, whether it's should we or shouldn't we have to wear masks according to our civil liberties, whether it's racial tension, removal of Confederate statues, whether it's what's going on in national anthems or before sporting events, whether it's what is going on in the political arena with all the bloodletting that is sure to come. We've seen what happens when we are pressed, when we are stressed, when we are fearful, frankly, when we are, as people always are, absent the Spirit of Christ. We've seen us at our worst. And at a time where the body of Christ should shine the brightest and be the most distinct from everything that we see around us, I'm afraid in too many instances, we have joined the fray. We have fought with worldly weapons. Let me be clear, and we will jump into our text. I have personally watched this unfold. Many of you have as well. I've had conversations with other ministers, I've had conversations with non-Christians and with Christians alike, and I'm aware of multiple congregations in jeopardy of losing members and outright splitting over the way that they have conducted and carried themselves on social media platforms. How sad is that? More than that, I've received countless screenshots from posts on controversial subjects and threads that have hurt brothers and sisters. They're not sure how to respond, how to handle this correctly. Some of these, at best, are insensitive or not very well thought through, and at worst, some of them are downright divisive, hateful, even racist. Let me be more clear, family. I'm not just speaking today about things I have seen at large. Some of these things we have seen even from us, among our number here. This is something we need to take seriously, because if we step back and we take a moment to consider everything we've seen and participated in out there in cyberspace, I think we're doing at leading people to Jesus. A friend of mine said this, and I don't know if there's a better way for me to sum it up. He said, "We've traded books for articles and articles for memes. With no tolerance for nuance, explanation, or context, we find one image, statistic, or quote to dismiss and vilify things we don't really understand." Well, and it's time for a change. Don't get me wrong, church, I believe that social media is a great tool. Those of you who are close to me and have dealt with me for very long know this. I'm constantly pushing for us to be able to innovate and connect with people there. I think we have to be much more intentional with spreading the message of Jesus there. I look forward to that. But in light of what we see, I think we're going to have to stop doing so much damage first before anyone will ever listen seriously to what we have to say. And I hope you'll join me in trying to do so much better. Our text this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Beginning in verse 23, Paul is writing to the Corinthian church and he says, "All things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor." Later he would say in verse 31, "So whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God. Just as I try to please everyone and everything, not seeking my own advantage, but for many, that they may be saved." I think it's really cool that Paul does make a distinction here. He says to Jews, Greeks, or the church, that means that we do have to worry about what we say live and direct and what we post digitally, how it will affect not just members of the church who we know largely agree with us, but everybody else as well. Paul says our witness and our testimony before men matters. He also says, yes, you have the right, and as Americans, we're very aware we have the right to free speech. He says you have the right, but that doesn't mean that it's profitable. That doesn't mean that it's beneficial. That doesn't mean that it's building anybody up. And if what you are saying and the work that you are doing and the things you're involving yourself in is not to glorify God and not to save those who are lost, then that shouldn't be your motivation. So I have just a couple of things I want to examine this morning. And I want to begin by saying this in case there's any question. What we say online matters. I heard somewhere along the line, I'm not sure where to attribute this quote, but that there are only three things in life you never get back. One, time. You don't get time back, you just get regrets in the end for things that you wish you would have done. You can't get bullets back and you can't get words back. The last two do a damage, and even if a bullet hole or wound heals, there will be a scar forever. And even if a word said is forgiven, the memory remains. Once you fire them out of the chamber, you don't get them back. What you say, you don't get to take back. What you post, you don't get to take back. Even, and this is just a little advice from your neighborhood friendly former IT guy, even if you delete it, guess what? When something goes out off of a device, it's like opening Pandora's box. It doesn't come back. Even the word delete, you delete something off of your phone, it doesn't really delete it. It just allocates the space that it was taking up and says that can be overwritten by something else. So it's probably still there. Same thing with your computer. But especially if it goes out into cyberspace on the internet. Because even if you delete the post, even if you delete the share, the impact and the image of all who saw it before you got to it will always be there. Someone probably has a screenshot or a snapshot somewhere, and that can always come back to bite you. How many politicians or celebrities have we seen from 10, 15 years ago have things drudged up against them, even if misleading, but just to illustrate the principle that once we put something out there, it's not coming back. That means we have to be very careful about what we choose to put out there. The Bible is filled with warnings about how devastatingly powerful words are. But Marcus, I know I have a tendency to think that I regret, and sometimes I post things too quickly. In the moment, I'm not thinking, but I always try to live right. I don't actually do anything wrong. My online persona is not really me, and people that know me know that's just how I am. I can't be held accountable for what I said when I was emotional or when I was angry. Well, I have good news for you. You should be really glad that in Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, Jesus said, "I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless deed they do, and by your actions you will be justified, and by your And you'll be condemned. Oh, wait. That's not how it reads. No, it reads very different. It reads that by our words, we will be judged. By our words, we'll have to give account. By our words, we'll be acquitted or condemned. I got a question, though, because that can seem kind of scary. And I think this is one of the questions we need to stop and ask before we say something online, post something online, respond to something online without thinking. This, I just want you to be honest with yourself. Two parts to it, but the first is this. When is the last time you actually won? Can you remember the last time you engaged somebody on a Facebook thread and actually changed their mind? Is there an instance? If we're judged by our words, and social media really becomes the same as speaking, then we have to ask why we are engaging in this way anyway. I mean, why do we have this intense desire to add voices to the melee? Everyone has a platform now, everyone has access, and everyone has freedom, but not all of those freedoms are beneficial. When's the last time that you got a message in your inbox that said, hey, I just want to let you know that hilarious meme that you just shared mocking my position and beliefs in life has totally opened my eyes to how stupid I've been. I want to thank you, and I'd like to talk about Jesus now. Has that ever happened? No? Just me? Second part of this question is just as important, and that's, when has something ever changed your mind? Can you honestly say that you've seen something that you were diametrically opposed to pop up in a Facebook feed, and you have realized the error of your ways and reached out to make reconciliation and restitution for what you've done before? In that public forum, when someone challenges you on your post that you're right and your beliefs and your country and your freedoms that are being taken away from you, has anyone ever changed your mind? There's no conservatives in the room that have changed their position on Alexandria Cortez based off of her monologue that she gave the other day about harassment in the workplace? No? Okay. There are no Democrats in the room that have changed their position on whether Donald Trump can save this country based on the fact that he plays baseball with kids in front of the White House? No? So this becomes the question that I have for us, church. We know that we're not changing anybody's mind. And if we know that nobody's changing our mind, then why are we spending so much energy to diligently proclaim and attempt these things online? Why are we getting so wound up? If we aren't actually affecting change, then we're only continuing to speak and post and share because we feel this internal need to tell everybody exactly how we feel. And it's natural for us to want people to know how we feel. Just don't allow ourselves, we can't allow ourselves to pretend that we're actually doing some good by doing so when what we're really doing is making our feelings feel better. Church, I know this seems blunt and strong, but there are families that are splitting, there are churches that are dividing, people feel uncomfortable worshiping with one another. We are ruining our witness before the nations, and for what? So that we can vent? So that we can be heard? Have we forgotten that we have access to the throne room of heaven? That we have His ear? That if we need to vent, that if we are upset, that we can speak with the Lord of the universe? Have we forgotten that He listens to His children? Are we so desperate for likes and shares and comments and affirmation that we betray that gift? Remember, Scripture tells us that a fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his own opinion. This should give us incredible pause when we go to speak, online or in person. If our goal is merely to express our own opinion, we may want to think twice about pressing share. Because once you fire that bullet, you don't get it back. The likes and hearts on your meme or post will never address the need that you have to be heard. Not like the arms of the Father can, the Father who made for you and came Himself for you. Do you need the eyes of the internet and your friend more than you need God's ears? Church, post less, pray more. The last thing I want to discuss this morning is probably the greatest threat that we have from this. And that is that I think we fall into the trap of inadvertently bearing false witness. And maybe you haven't concerned it like this or thought of it like this. This concept in Scripture goes all the way back to Exodus chapter 20, where the Scripture says, and the children of Israel were commanded not to bear false witness. And it sounds like a command just not to tell lies. But the command goes further. It says, do not bear false witness against your neighbor. And that means that if you accuse your neighbor of anything, especially a crime, it better not be false in any way. See, in the Old Testament days, there was no, DNA. There were no even lie detectors. There were no forensic files. They couldn't break down a crime scene and figure things out where there were no witnesses. So everything relied on eyewitness testimony. That means that your willingness to be truthful and to abstain from bearing false witness carried a ton of weight. That's why you could be put to death for bearing false witness. Now, even though we have those things now, false witness still carries the same weight because it can destroy someone's life. Have you ever been the victim of a spread rumor, church? Paul multiple times addresses this. False witness is closely linked to slander and gossip, and for a while, gossip only used to occur around the water cooler or on the back pew before you left services, but now it takes place online all the time at the click of a finger. Paul talks about this in so many places they're hard to enumerate. Romans chapter 1 and verse 29, Ephesians 4, 31, Colossians 3 and 8, 2 Corinthians 12 and 20 all talk about gossip and malice and slander. When we share rumors or conjecture, we proliferate slanted articles and opinion pieces. When we share memes, especially about people, trying to mock them with the intention of ruining reputations, we become part of the problem. This is magnified by this overarching condition that we find ourselves in right now, and that's that a large portion of what you see and read in the news online is intentionally curated to provoke, divide, provoke an emotional reaction. It's slanted, it's misleading. Why would we want to have any part of pushing those things and continuing to share those things around? When we see a meme or graphic, when we see an opinion, when we see a copy, if you agree, we need to seriously consider the possibility that we could very likely be bearing false witness. Example, just yesterday I saw a lady post about a crime that happened. It was terrible. It was true. A boyfriend and girlfriend were senselessly tortured and murdered in Tennessee, and it showed the suspects below, and the text of the article in the post said, why isn't there a national outcry? Because the victims are white and the assailants are black? A Christian shared this post. I went and researched what happened with this case, and the reason why it's not in national circulation right now is because it happened in 2007. Yet, the post was used to try and promote the idea that there's a race war happening. And if a Christian shares that post, what does that look like to not just the world around, but to other brothers and sisters who might be cut from a different cloth? This also happened with Chick-fil-A, and I knew I was going to bring this up at some point because you don't touch the Lord's chicken. Back when all the protests erupted, we started seeing this fly around Facebook, and I don't know if anyone from our congregation posted, but if you did, this is not a direct shot at you. But this is just to illustrate the principle. When this happened, there started to be this push online that we need to weaponize police officers and black people against each other. These two groups need to be in conflict. Therefore, if you back one, you can't back the other. And Christians everywhere were very, very excited that they didn't have to stop eating Chick-fil-A because this picture surfaced. And yes, doggone it, Chick-fil-A backs the blue. There's only one problem with this photo, and there's only one problem with taking that stance and using it to promote a conflict between the two people groups. That is that this photo was actually taken in 2015. It was not a response to the protest. It was not in any way a response to what was happening with the Black Lives Matter movement. It was not a response to any of that at all. But it was being weaponized to bear false witness and create dissension amongst people groups that would otherwise be united. You may have seen this and thought, I'm really happy that Chick-fil-A is doing that. I'm going to share that because I'm going to get my nugs as soon as they open on Monday. But what were you really communicating? False witness. Now, these are simple examples. These are not serious. I mean, they're serious. They're misinterpreted. They're serious because they cause division. It might be a little bit funny because it's Chick-fil-A. But listen, guys, this is the nature of almost everything you're seeing proliferated out there today. Christians cannot afford to be caught in this. We cannot afford to be a part of this system. We cannot afford to be a part of this cycle. Once a claim is made, whether it is fully false, partly false, or true, it takes on a life of its own, and now it's out in the wild. The responsibility to end the cycle with every single Christian when they see these things come across their feed. If you feel the need to address it, please don't do it publicly. Please send a private message that says, hey, I'm not sure if you're aware. Some of the details were left out. If you still think this post has value, you can leave it. I just know that's not your heart and what you intended to communicate, so forth and so on. But certainly it shouldn't continue to be shared by you. It shouldn't be passed on by you. If you've ever had a rumor spread about you that was even partly false and left the wrong impression on people, and it got down the line so far before you even found out, what's it like to try and go back and repair that? What's it feel like? It's infuriating, isn't it? We should never put ourselves in the position of this, ever. Listen, even politicians, even the people that you hate, even the people that you don't like, even Bill Gates, Dr. Fauci, Colin Kaepernick, they're all real people. A friend of mine may have said this best. He said, they all have families and feelings and strengths and weaknesses, critics and fans, but most importantly, they're image bearers of God. Every Republican, every Democrat, every conservative, every liberal, every politician, and every celebrity, every single person in the world is made in the image of our God, and how we speak about them should reflect the fact that we regard them as God's image bearers. This doesn't mean that we should never or will never disagree with people in the public circle. It doesn't mean that they're never guilty of wrongdoing, but it does mean we should never repeat something about someone that has even the slightest possibility of being false, half-true, missing context, slanted, twisted, designed to provoke, designed to divide. If you cannot, beyond the shadow of a doubt, verify that the post or meme or statement is fully factual, if you can't verify that it's not misleading or leaving context, if you can't be sure that it bears no false witness, then as a Christian, we have no business. But Marcus, and this is not accusatory, this is just on. But Marcus, doesn't that mean that close to 100% of what is out there, I can't share or talk about because pretty much everything is slanted or misleading or concocted or created? Doesn't that mean that I pretty much can't say anything since everything that gets published nowadays is broken? Can I say anything? Well, I can only tell you what Paul told you already. You have the freedom. You have the right. You have the ability to say whatever you want. Just remember, not all things are beneficial. Not all things are productive. Not all things are profitable. And should we not, as the household of God, be more focused on saying and sharing things that build up, glorify, and redeem? Again, my friend says, accuse and criticize very few people, and do so seldomly. The more you accuse others, the higher the possibility you will be guilty of falsely accusing. And Proverbs says, when words are many, transgression is not lacking, but whoever restrains his lips is prudent. In short, the more gossip and memes you share, the more likely you are to be guilty of spreading false witness, and bearing false witness is a serious sin as any other. Is it worth it? I'm going to bring us home now. I'm going to end this Facebook rant. Has anyone bothered to read to the ending? If you have, copy and share with 10 friends. There are some things that we say sometimes that in conclusion I want us to reassess and reevaluate. One of them is on the screen now. I know you've seen this, you've felt this before. We've all been tempted to share. Maybe we've shared some things about it. Let's see who has the guts to share this. I bet none of my friends will share this. Have you seen that? I don't have any room but to be painfully honest about this, family. Is this even the kind of question that Christians should be asking? relation to our outward witness to people around us? See, the beginning of this statement, let's see who has the guts, in and of itself contains the idea that what is following is going to be divisive. It already knows there's a tension there that it's playing, and it's designed to play on bravado and pride and guilt. It's implying that a person not taking the action it suggests is gutless. It doesn't matter if the statement is true, church. Is that really the messaging of the heart and hope that God has given to you? Anyone who doesn't like it could just unfollow me, Marcus. Have you been here? I'm not attacking anybody because I love the unfollow feature. There's some people that I love and they mean well, but I just can't. I wish they had the unfollow feature back when Facebook was first coming into its heyday and people started sending Farmville requests, because I had to unfriend a lot of people who just kept asking me for crops every day, and I wish I could have just unfollowed them and maintained the relationship. Everyone remembers when Facebook games were a big problem, but now we have the unfollow feature, so we can subtly stop seeing what people post without actually letting them know that I really can't be bothered to pay you any attention anymore because you are just ridiculous. I have seen so many Christians sharing posts or creating posts that express this sentiment. And before you do again, I want you to consider this. I get it. We want to be heard. I want to be heard. We want to be validated. We have things that we feel that we need to voice, that we believe in, but we need to be very careful because there are a lot of problems with this statement as a Christian. We could have spent the entire day right here, but we're almost done, I promise. The first thing that I want to say about a statement like this is, one, we enjoy incredible amounts of freedom. That is true. We enjoy national liberties, and we're indeed thankful. We have no desire to see those dissolve or be taken away, and I know that's what you fear, and I know it's often what causes us or provokes us to make these sorts of posts anyway. But remember that we must respect and enjoy our spiritual liberties in a far greater priority and capacity than we do our civil liberties. We must give priority of our spiritual liberties over our national liberties. I do not mean just in exercising them. I'm reminded that in our text today, Paul said, I have the right to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Marcus, it's my social media, and I should get to decide what I share on it. If people don't like it, they don't have to read it. Hey, listen. You're right. But are you a Christian? Then everything you are and have and do wears the name of Jesus Christ. You are absolutely not your own, nothing that you voice, for you were bought with a price. Your social media is a platform and your voice, your sphere of influence, and that means it's a part of you too, and there should be no part of you that God does not get to. There's no part of you that doesn't count. So yes, you have the freedom to decide what you get to post and share, but you also have the responsibility to steward that freedom well, and you have an obligation to see that your social media serves His purpose, just like the rest of your life serves His purpose. When you say to somebody, you can just unfriend me if you don't like it, you are also saying, I forfeit any witness and influence I may have previously had with you and on you. You are also saying, I forfeit any future opportunity to build a meaningful relationship with you. You are also saying, I forfeit my chance by God's design to be involved in your life in some way, and I do no longer care for my opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with you. When you say, just unfriend me, you are saying the opportunity to be an influence and a voice in that person's life is no longer valuable to you. And if you trace that back to the post that you made, whether it was about politics or national anthems or monuments, I wonder how small that issue feels in the grand scheme of souls and the gospel. You destroy your chance to build a meaningful relationship and you sacrifice your role in God's plan for them on the altar of your own personal freedom and pride. Are you willing to send all that up in flames for your meme? Are you willing to go that far for your politics? Are you willing to lose all of your influence for mask regulations or athletic for a rant an opinion piece by your favorite news journalist? Are you willing to go that far for insensitive, racially charged memes? Is that a hill that all the good news of Jesus should die on? Anyone who doesn't like it can unfollow me. Church, what if you were supposed to be the one that they could follow all the way to the foot of the cross? Where nothing else matters. What if you had influence? What if you had trust? What if it's not so much about whether they agreed with you, but what your influence and your voice could point them to? What if we worship in one world and post in another? Family, if they aren't unfollowing you to follow Jesus instead, then we have missed the mission. Church, as we go forward, it's going to be a whole new way of doing life, and how we carry ourselves with one another and with respect to the world outside matters. It always has, but it does especially now. There are going to be things that frustrate you. There are things that frustrate me right now. I'm not immune to any of this. I'm guilty as any. There are going to be things that you want to be heard. There are going to be things that you see that make no sense or seem in the moment to express how you feel deep down inside. And I'm not criticizing how you feel today. What I'm saying is that how you feel and what you want others to know about it should never gain priority over how you feel about Jesus and what you want others to know about Him. I'm saying that we must have the humility to surrender our need to be heard so that He can be seen. I'm saying that we have to care if the world unfollows us because they're supposed to be following us right to Him. Before you post or share something, church, please take a step back and ask yourself, what am I trying to communicate with this post? Will this post bring glory to God? Whose mind will this post change? And then ask yourself, why do you need those who you already know will disagree to see this post more than you need them to see Jesus? Why do you need to say it more than you need to have to continue the chance for them to see Him through you? If you can't take this scripture here in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 honestly and say what I'm about to say, what I'm about to post, what I'm about to share is going to be profitable, is going to add to the chance that souls will be saved and see Jesus. If you can't honestly say that it won't be a stumbling block to anyone, if you can't honestly say that it's not just an exercise of my civil liberties, if you can't honestly say that it's going to glorify God by genuinely seeking the good of others, I implore you, church, don't press send. Your witness depends on it. Your testimony depends on it. Paul finished by saying, whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or the church of God, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, that they may be saved. I'll leave you with this thought this morning, church. We have a much, much more important message to get out. And I hope that we choose to. But we will never have the chance if the world unfollows you. We follow a man named Jesus who is also caught up in false witness. We follow a man named Jesus who suffered and willfully submitted to the mob that was howling around him for the betterment of each and every one of us. We follow a man who has given us hope beyond what anything in this world can offer. We follow one who we say we imitate. We follow one who has called us to bring others to follow Him. And my final word this morning is to say, if He can silently endure all of the things that were hurled at Him and said around Him in that howling mob, then we as Christians today can endure whatever we see scroll through our Facebook feed in silence too. What is this man to you? We're going to sing an invitation song here in just a second. It may be the case that you're convicted by this message. It may be the case that you're seeking someone who can save you from all of the noise. get to the first place. If either is the case, we stand ready to assist you. We love you and we'd be happy to pray with you. Will you come as we stand and sing?